Hey, good morning, everyone. This is Dr. Bill from World Bible School, and I'm doing a Facebook Live because Zoom is still having some issues today, and I don't know what they are, but nonetheless, good to see David Jacobs, our board member. Good to see Robert Dungay, who some of you tried to watch last night, but because of the Facebook issues, not Facebook, but Zoom, I was not able to go on. So I don't have my backgrounds. I don't have any of that because Zoom is down. Good to see Chaplain Shane Gabbert. Good to see Sharon Anderson and others that are joining us today. So even though I don't have Zoom and I don't have my backgrounds, you can see my green screen there. But I just wanted to go live and share with you what is going on. So anyway, I want to talk to you for a few minutes this morning about ever-increasing knowledge. And I came up with that title realizing this morning that we were not able to do this Zoom broadcast. And while I still have my old BeLive format, still I just wanted to go on here like this and do this broadcast this way. So I'm not going to hold you a long time, but I want to talk to you about ever-increasing knowledge. You know, I grew up in a very large Pentecostal denomination. I grew up in a Pentecostal mindset, and I literally, good to see Dr. Faye joining this morning. I literally came up under an extreme traditional mindset of scripture interpretation as being literal and stick to what you know, stick to what you've been taught and all of that. And probably a lot of you have too. And I mean, that's really cool. Okay. So, you know, I have made mistakes in my life of throwing away valuable information when there was things I should have retained. But one of the things we've noticed is that knowledge is increasing. And you know, the Bible says that, okay? And I'm not pulling out a scripture this morning that says that knowledge will increase, but you all should know that this is a biblical principle. So it's not anything new that I'm sharing with you in that light, but I just want to talk to you about this, and I'm going to present a couple of passages this morning. But my reason for this is I was just thinking about how that what we're hearing today, like unconditional love, no limits to the Father's love, and things of that nature, when we do that, what it sounds like a brand new message. It sounds like something we've never heard before, and the reality is that it isn't something that we've never heard before. It's literally a message that is important to us. You know, it's not like we've never heard this before, but it sounds new. It sounds strange, a lot of the things that are being taught today. And I'm as guilty when it comes to teaching fresh material. And I want to say to you that it's not new, okay? It's not brand new stuff. It literally is the original truth of Scripture that we just didn't know about. You know, I was in the ministry. I started preaching at the age of 17 in 1972, and I literally came into having my first Strong's Concordance probably 10 or 11 years later, and really it didn't become a valuable tool in my life probably for another 20 years or even longer. But even though revelation was coming to me little by little, and sometimes Dr. Faye and I talked about this, sometimes it was very little, okay, but little by little revelation would come, and sometimes it really seemed slow. But the thing is that it came, okay? And so I say that to say this, that we literally are hearing revelation like we've never heard before. We're hearing things that sounds non-traditional. And, you know, the Bible says in Colossians 2, verse 3, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And the Passion Translation says, for our spiritual wealth is in him, like hidden treasure waiting to be discovered, heaven's wisdom and endless riches of revelation knowledge. And so what we've done is we've looked at Scripture in a literal way. Let me give you an example. Hebrews 11 verse 6 says, "For without faith, it is impossible to please God." Now, without faith to me always meant not having faith. And so I found myself believing early on in my ministry that it was possible to have zero faith. And the Bible says, like those who have no faith, in some settings, Jesus said to his disciples in the boat on the sea when the storm was there, he said, "Why is it that you have no faith?" But again, we've been so schooled in the King James and the New King James, and even though I still cling to the New King James and I study by the King James because that's where most of our study helps are, still we have clung to those interpretations or those translations as if everything else that comes was in error, and that's not true. The reality is that when we read that without faith it's impossible to please him, actually when you go back to the first language, the original language rather, in the first century, which was Greek and Aramaic and Chaldee and so on, when you look at the Greek and Latin, when you look at the Greek language, you find that it's not saying without faith it's impossible to please him. You're seeing, reading that it's without exercising faith it's impossible to please him. And him, of course, is a word that can be replaced from the next sentence by the word God. But you know, I didn't do this on my own, but one day I was studying and Holy Spirit asked me a question and said, "Have you looked at the word please?" Now, Holy Spirit would know that, okay? But just to taunt me, just to try to get me to look at something, he said that. So I went to the word please, and I studied it all the way out to its very root word. And I found that what that word meant was to fully agree be fully agreeable. And so the way that scripture would translate, at least the first half of that scripture, it would say, without exercising faith, it's impossible to fully agree with God. And so I think what he's saying to us is that, you know, here we have a scripture that we've clung to our entire lives, but yet there was another interpretation, a deeper interpretation from the original time period that it was spoken in. And I think what God was saying to us is that without really believing what he says, that we're not really agreeing with him. And that makes sense to me. And so when this scripture here in Colossians says, "For our spiritual wealth is in him," it's not in a Bible, and I believe in the Bible. I believe we should study the Bible. I believe we should know the Bible backwards and forwards and study every bit of Hebrew and Greek that we can to learn what it says. However, when you use things like one of the early Bible helps, the Strong's Concordance, was written in 1890, which was about 1800 years after the New Testament time period. And so, you know, James Strong did a great job. There are others who did a great job. They're the Thayer's lexicon that was written somewhere around the same time period. But we really do need Holy Spirit, and we need to unscramble these words and look at the metaphors and the figure of speech type things from Jewish culture and to see what they mean. So here this says, "For our spiritual wealth is in him." So it's not in a scripture per se, although it is in the scriptures, but it's also in the eternal Christ. You know, the Bible said the Holy Spirit would come and show us or tell us all things that he has said. Well, is all things that Jesus said only locked to that 3.5 year time period? No, it's not. It's not that at all. What Jesus said is eternal. So before time was time, as he began to speak, even as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the fullness of God as one, began to speak, the Bible, I believe, is teaching us that God will even unlock that revelation to us. So our spiritual wealth is in him like hidden treasure waiting to be discovered. So who's discovering it? We are. Because he already has unveiled it to us. The Bible teaches us also that it was God's will to unveil these mysteries. And he tells us what the mystery is. The mystery is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And so he says, heaven's wisdom and endless riches of revelation knowledge. Now, let me take you to another portion of scripture. And this will be what I want to hit on and just share for a few minutes. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 9 through 12. And I'm going to look at the New King James, but I also want to look at the Passion Translation. He says, "For we know in part, and we prophesy in part." So, in other words, there's something that we do not understand, at least at this point in time, and meaning that there is something more to it that we can gain. And so, as we look at that, what is it that we can gain that we have missed? Well, we know in part, and we prophesy in part. So, in other words, what prophetic thing you utter, whether by you call it prophecy or you call it preaching, what the partial knowledge we have, that's what we will speak. It says, but when that which is perfect is come, that which is complete has come, then that which is in part will be done away. So in other words, there will be a time, and there was a time, and that was Christ. This was prophetic of Christ. You say, but this is 1 Corinthians and Paul's teaching. Yes, it was, but you can see Christ and you can see the cross all in the book of Revelation as well. So we need to quit limiting Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to all that Jesus said and all that Jesus did, because that's not so. There are other parts of the Revelation. Even after Christ died, heaven was unveiled to mankind. Same thing we have going on today. So, but when that which is perfect or complete has come, then that which is in part will be done away. In other words, the partial will be done away, but a fuller revelation will be unveiled to us. And it says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, or when I became mature, I put away childish things. In other words, I stopped seeing things at an immature level. I started seeing things at a more full level. And then he says, for now we see in a mirror. Now, what is he talking about, now we see in a mirror? Paul is speaking to the Corinthian people. You know, it's said that Romans may have been his first missionary journey. First and Second Corinthians may have been his second and third, but theologically, it's generally applied to Paul as his first missionary journey here in 1 Corinthians. And so in that journey, he's telling people, in the first century, for now I see in a mirror. For now we see in a mirror. So can this apply to us? The answer is yes, because this is a picture of the carnal mind that is coming into maturity, but at the same time, sometimes it's not all that fast, and that's okay. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, and then we see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall be known as I am also known. Now, this is not talking about when I get to heaven, then I'll be known. It's not talking about that. So let's put that out of the picture. So let's go to the Passion Translation and see what else we can uncover from this in the next few minutes. It says in 1 Corinthians 13, 9 through 12, the Passion Translation, our present knowledge and our prophecies are but partial or fragments. But when love's perfection arrives, or another way to say arrives here would be manifests, when love's perfection manifests, the partial will fade away. When I was a child, I spoke about childish matters, for I saw things like a child, and I reasoned like a child. But the day came when I matured, and I set aside my childish ways. For now, and this is not talking about necessarily how I acted, that I didn't have any childish ambitions or childish way of seeing things. This is talking about my mindset. This is talking about maturing in our understanding. And so he says in verse 12, for now we see but a faint reflection of riddles and mysteries. This word mysteries here is a word that we actually adopted it more or less in our English language, and it's the word ainigma. We call it enigma, but ainigma, as though reflected in a mirror. But one day we will see face to face, or this can be translated as mouth to mouth, and I want to talk about that here in a moment. My understanding, Paul says, is incomplete now, but one day I will understand everything, just as everything about me has been fully understood. So are we coming into revelation? Yes. This is the season for ever increasing knowledge. And I would just say that it's always been the season. It's just that we've not grabbed some things. We've not embraced some things. And so it's easy to say, you know what, I've believed this my whole life and I'm going to stick to this, and come to a place of utter stubbornness and reject revelation knowledge. But see, that's not the Father's plan at all. The Father's plan is for us to ever increase in His knowledge, or in the revelation of truth. And so as we do that, here's just a few thoughts about this passage. And I was going to talk about this last night with Dr. Don Keithley, but we had a Zoom issue. So Zoom has outages in the West Coast, a little bit, quite a bit in the East Coast, and some throughout, some blots if you look at the Zoom map. I didn't get to talk about that with Dr. Don. But let me just say this, that perfect love puts everything else in second place. Why? Because God is love. So that means when I say my revelations are accurate, you know what I tell my students? I tell my students in WBSU, and I should say our students in WBSU, I tell them that, you know, what I know, I'm pretty solid on, but check back with me tomorrow or next week, because that could adjust, because knowledge is ever increasing. And so what I just say is that when you put love first place, everything else is second place. When we started World Bible School University, we did it on the basis of, you know, Dr. Fay and I had been through the Pentecostal movement and the Word of Faith movement and the Charismatic movement and the Kingdom movement and the Grace movement, and not saying those things aren't important, because they are important. Amen? They're very important. But, you know, someone asked one time, you've got the Pentecostals against the Charismatics and the Word of Faith against the Catholics, and you've got the this against the that. And I said, not me. I'm all of those. Well, what I meant by that is that I have gleaned from a lot of the things that I have been involved in. But I just moved to a place where when we started WBSU, we founded it on a principle, a biblical principle, which is the principle of unconditional love. I know there are people out there who don't like unconditional love. I know there are grace people who claim to be grace people, and I'm not knocking them, because this fits all kinds of formats. But I know there are people out there who really do believe in the grace of God to the degree that I can say anything, I can do anything, I can live anyway. And I get it. God will love you no matter what. But when we claim that we are people of unconditional love, also of grace, and we don't apply grace to people's lives, the Bible says that grace, our conversation or our manner of living, is to be laced with grace. And so it's very important, above all things, that we love each other, even with our differences, okay? And so Paul is contrasting here spiritual gifts with love, saying gifts will fail, but love will never fail. And of course, you've read that in 1 Corinthians 13, as you read the love chapter, you know. But the fact is that here in this passage, as Paul is talking, there's an analogy that the Passion Translation commentary uses, that it's like leaves falling to the ground. Something greater will one day take their place, which is the love of God. Now, for me, I have always been the kind of a person who I always felt like I was out there on a limb. You know what I mean is, I felt like my theology was kind of out there, and I love, you know, being out there. I love doing the things that I do and teaching what I teach. But the fact is that sometimes that happens because our knowledge is dim, or the mystery doesn't seem to be clear, and we're drawing straws trying to shoot for something. A lot of times, you know, Dr. Kate Fairchild says that the best fruit is out there on the limb. We know that to be true. If a piece of fruit falls to the ground, we also know that something else will take its place. And that's the love of God. When I teach college, I try to make sure every scripture and everything I say and do is funneled through the lens of love. Now, real quickly, the English word we've seen in two translations. We've seen the English words dimly or mysteries. And in the King James Version even uses the word darkly. We see through a glass darkly. But this comes from the Greek word ainigma, which is really very close to the English pronunciation of the word. And honestly, I don't know that I've even pronounced this word accurately in the English. I think I know the word better in the Greek than I do in the English. But the fact is that this word enigma, and it's really ainigma in the Greek, and it's enigma in the English, I believe. This English word, this Greek word that we're using, the word is defined as a person or thing that is mysterious, puzzling, or difficult to understand. Well, one of the things I believe that's happened to us is we've focused more on Scripture, and again, we need to stick to the Scripture and properly translated. But we've really let that replace our relationship with God. We based our relationship with God on Scripture. While the Scriptures lead us to Christ, the Scriptures, you know, Paul said one time that, you know, in the Scriptures you think you have eternal life, or because you know the Bible you think you have eternal life. Well, eternal life is something we've had ever since before the foundation of the world, but because we're in eternal life, okay, or we're in eternity, we're a part of eternity. But when Paul talks about one day we will see face to face, I think this refers to our thoughts being realigned to Father's eternal mind already implanted with us or within us from before the foundation of the universe. And when Paul talks about this, it is said that he's actually referencing God speaking to Moses face to face. But in the Hebrew language, this seems to be translated as mouth to mouth. And one of the things that we understand about love is that we need to understand that the same transforming love of God brings mankind into a face-to-face or a mouth-to-mouth revelation of who he is. Because face-to-face is really not the accurate way to view this. Mouth-to-mouth would be more accurate in that it's part of the Hebrew language. But here's something else, that this is when our perception of God and all of his creation begins to change, and we encounter the renewing or the transforming of our carnal mind or our thoughts, and upgrade to what Father thinks in his mind. You know, when we talk about getting revelation, oftentimes I talk about how that I'm getting fresh downloads of revelation. And I love that, because the reality is that whether you call it getting a fresh download or a fresh upload, still we get these fresh uploads of information. And this it's called an upgrade. You know, sometimes computers, I love computers, I love technology. I have a computer degree. I don't know everything about computers inside and out, but where I come in most of the time is software application. What I mean by that is when something doesn't work right, I'm really better at solving that problem than I am if you've got a bad hard drive or your CPU is bad, your motherboard is bad. Those are things I'm not super familiar with. But one of the things I do understand about computers is that we're always getting upgrades. Well, to get an upgrade, you first have to download the upgrade. So you download the upgrade, which is the same as downloading information. So you get a supernatural download, and that download begins to be funneled through the lens that you use, which needs to be the lens of God's unconditional love. And that download becomes now an upgrade of information. Now, back to this phrase, face-to-face. This phrase, face-to-face, can also be translated as face-into-face, which is a picture of us being united as his many-membered body, who are of the one mind, of one mind and one function. Remember what John said, that as he is, so are we in this world. And so when we think about face-into-face, we need to understand the concept a little more clearly, because face into face, we get the idea that we were created, and all of a sudden now, because we have a human separatist type identity, that must be how it is. That's not how it is. Okay, you never left God. Okay, now you have an appearance. Say like this. Say there's 50 people together, huddled together real tight, and you look into the mirror, you see the reflection. Now, say this 50 people huddled together is in God, is a part of God. God created him, boom, there's 50 people. Now, that's billions and billions, but let's just say there's 50. And you see the reflection in this giant walled mirror, and you see that 50 people, that reflection doesn't become the people. That reflection is just a reflection of this group of people. And so this reflection is what you see in this reflection. People think, that's my identity. So we have a natural realm awareness, and we think that's who we are. No, this natural realm awareness is simply influenced by what we see, what we hear, what we touch, what we think, and that's a carnal perception. And Paul said, look, you know, I was a child. I spoke about childish matters. Because I saw and reasoned like a child. But when I matured, I set aside my childish ways. So the thing I want to leave with you today, not just this thought of ever-increasing knowledge, but that as knowledge moves forward, it will increase. Again, you will get a heavenly download or a supernatural download, and that becomes your upload of information. And in that, what happens is you begin to see no longer through a glass darkly, or no longer through a glass that presents an enigma. It now becomes the mystery unveiled, the puzzling unscrambled. Things that are difficult to understand are no longer difficult to understand. Things change. Now, as long as we reject that and we continue to see through a glass darkly, that just means that we'll continue to have a veiled understanding of who God is. And then the reflection, the mirrored reflection as you, that will be a mystery also. God doesn't want us to live that way. God wants you to live in peace, in joy, in happiness, in all the things that he does. But that comes through understanding who he is as you look at even Father God through the lens of unconditional love. And then in turn, you look at everybody else that way. Because as God is one, so are we. And the scriptures say that. And I, as much as I study and research, I believe that to be an absolute truth. So the enigma has gone away. It's not hidden. It's not mysterious. It's not puzzling. It's clear. God is love. And God moves in his mindset of love through us to everybody else. So even though I didn't have Zoom this morning, I didn't have my green screen, my backgrounds, still I wanted to share with you this little bit of revelation, and I wanted you to be able to see that, you know, knowledge is increasing. Don't be afraid. I would say there are teachers out there who are teaching some really goofy stuff. Now, I've been in this for 48 years I've been teaching, but I've also been in ministry my whole life. My parents were ministers and so on. But let me just say it this way. There are some goofy things out there. You don't have to get involved in them. You don't have to take part in the goofiness. If it seems too free or too out there, there might be a reason for it. Listen to solid teaching that someone can sit down with you and say, here's what the scripture says. Here's another version of that same scripture. And here's some of the Greek and here's some of the meanings of that. And that can explain to you how line upon line, precept upon precept, and you can actually see and understand it coming together. So that was what was on my heart. That's what I wanted to share with you. Dr. Catherine plans to be back next week with me. We plan to move right on with our broadcast. I'm sure that Zoom will get this resolved, and I'm keeping an eye on it. So thank you so much, and I'll see you next time. Have a great day. Bye-bye, everyone.